Welcome to White Wall Wednesday, where we explore how to create images in your own home with a blank wall or whatever you have available. And last week we took a look at a really fun image where I composited myself from my blank white wall onto a rooftop. And I want to show you today how we can actually edit that image to make it more atmospheric and believable and just really create a world of our own. I'm so excited to show this to you because this represents the type of image that just captures my heart and my imagination. I love any image that has a lot of atmosphere to it. And when I use that word atmospheric, what I'm talking about is sort of a sense of tangibility in the image where it feels like you could touch it because of all the textures and the richness of the color and all of those things. So we're going to dive into Photoshop. I'm going to show you my process, but especially how we can add a dramatic sky into the background and how we can really enhance those colors to create an image that feels really beautiful and wonderful. In my last video, we talked about how I already had this image of a roof. And because I already had this image of a roof that I shot in Brazil 3 years ago, I knew exactly where I would end up in the picture. Because I already had this image, I knew the angle that I had to get on my body, even though I didn't totally match that up right, but we'll talk about that. I knew the color palette that I was working with. I knew the lighting that was going on that day. It was really overcast and kind of gray, so that made it really neutral. So I already knew all of those things, lighting and angle, that make such a difference when you're creating a composite. So I shot my images to reflect that. This is one of the images that I photographed, and this is one of the images that I might add in. I haven't even decided yet which one is going to go in, but I know that I'll need at least the light from the candles here. And then we have a lot more images that are candidates to go in. I chose this one for the hair. So we have a lot of options here to add in. And then I have some extra images as well, like smoke that we're going to add in that I shot on a black backdrop. And some clouds that will be vital to creating a really dynamic image here. So let's go back to our rooftop. And what I'm going to do first is just take a step back here so we can see the whole image. And what I really want to do is composite these two images together. I took images of this rooftop and I shot the upper part of it and the lower to capture this wall. So I'm going to start with this wall image and expand my frame outward with the crop tool. I'm not sure exactly how big I need this canvas to be, so I'm just guessing. And I'm just going to combine these two images. And there might be some things that you notice about this process that might seem a little bit off, and I wanna try to explain those to you as we go. For example, there's this weird sort of rectangular box happening here, and that was another part of the building. And I'm just going to get rid of that and all of the foliage in the background. So what you see in the background will not be in the final image. I'm creating a layer mask here, making sure that I'm on black at 100% opacity. Take my brush size up considerably and hardness at 0 for a nice soft fuzzy brush just to combine these two images. So what you'll notice right away is that these are not lining up. We have this image here where we can see this little marker isn't lined up, and that's okay. That just means that I need to move one image onto the next one exactly where it goes. And essentially what that did is it made me realize that things are just not going to be lined up perfectly, and that's okay. What lined up right here made this go out of alignment, and that's totally normal for compositing, particularly with straight lines, but we don't have to worry about it. We're going to find a way around it. So I'm going to keep erasing. I'm going to make my brush size even bigger just to make it as fuzzy as possible. There we go. And I'm just blending the roof tiles in. And the bigger and fuzzier your brush is, the more leeway you have in terms of things not really lining up. So like right here, I just kind of did a big fuzzy brush, and you can hardly tell where I've erased, right? It's like pretty difficult to discern. And that's great. That's what I'm looking for. I'm looking to create an image here that is seamless, at least to the regular viewer. And we'll see how well we do with that. So I'm just erasing. It looks pretty good to me. And we can always toggle the eyeball. So you can see it's warping, like it's not quite in place. And there are certain things that you would worry about normally that I'm not going to, like the tree area back here. You can see that we've duplicated leaves in that tree area, but that's not a problem for me because I'm going to erase this whole background, including our satellite dish there. So that'll be the next step that I undertake by creating a blank layer. And I'm just going to take my brush tool and select just a neutral gray in the background. And I'm going to fill this blank layer in with this neutral gray, which actually is slightly green, but I'm good with that. So I'm just filling in. Pretty simply, and I'm not touching the roof. What I'm doing is filling in all of the blank space and not really going near the roof yet. And in order to fill that part in, I'm going to zoom in and I'm going to make my brush size a lot smaller so we can really get around the edges of the roof. And I'm also going to take the hardness of my brush up so that it matches the sharpness of my object that I am going to brush right up against. So here we go. This is going to take some time because I'm going to be fairly precise in going around the roof. So let's speed it up. I like to turn my canvas. And the reason why I do that is because my hand is just steadier when I brush in a vertical motion rather than horizontal. So I like to rotate my canvas to match the way my hand is steadiest. And that's what I'm doing here. It's like night and day looking at this image now. When you get rid of that whole background that's really, really distracting, now we just see the rooftop. And that's exactly what I want here, is just to see the roof and really focus the attention. Part of what I love about imagery is when imagery is super simple and yet also symbolic. And that's like the place that I live. I just love that. So when I create images, it's pretty common for me to just erase the background out of an image because I find backdrops to be very distracting in nature in particular. There's a lot going on out in the world. Even when you're just in a simple field or a forest, there are so many little things that catch the eye, like shadows and highlights, little details, leaves, pieces of grass. So in this case, I've just gotten rid of it so we can just focus on our subject. And part of what I might do here is create a slight fog effect. And if you want to do that in your images, you can just create a blank layer like I'm doing here. I'm just going to sample the color that we were already using in the backdrop, making my brush quite a bit bigger and taking the hardness all the way down. Now I'm going to move on to my opacity and take that down as well. And then just on a separate layer, lightly go over the edges of the roof, just where you want to see it fade away into fog, which I think will be really beautiful. So that's just a little fog layer that we've made. I think that looks pretty good. And I'm going to plot myself right about here. This is the image that I liked best, and it's really kind of a weird choice because there were images with a lot more going on, and I just felt a connection to this picture. Like somehow it really captured the feeling that I wanted in this picture overall. So I'm going to use this one and add on hair, add on flame and light to my body, which might be the difficult way of doing this, but that's okay. It's just what I felt connected to. And that's important to note, which is, you know, if you feel a particular connection to an image, go with your gut on that. There's no right way to do this. So I'm just going with my gut, pasting myself in. I'm going to make myself smaller to fit on this rooftop a little bit better. And I also need to just slightly move my body so that I really do fit. I think we'll go with something around that size here. Yeah, there we go. I think that looks good. And if I wanted to warp my knees into place so that my knees were bent down a little bit more, I can always do that now. Instead of rotating my whole body, just go into Edit, Transform, Warp. And from here, I can just move my legs up or down, you know, in whatever position without having to move my whole body forward, which can be a little bit weird, just moving my head back so it looks like I'm sitting up on this slant. So you can see what that did, just going back here in history. you know, trying not to warp my head too much or my body, but I think that looks pretty good. I like the size that I am. I'm actually not loving this bottom part of the wall very much. I think it's kind of distracting, so I'll probably crop it up. Let's just do that now. We can establish our square frame, which is what I always create personally, but that is certainly not mandatory. And I'm just cropping this to the point where I am in the middle, exact middle of the frame. Now we're missing, the strip of white is missing its pixels, so back on layer two, I'm just going to fill in what we didn't have from before, just filling in those pixels with the green-gray color in the backdrop. And now we can move on to erasing the subject into the shot. Part of this will just be really straightforward layer masking, so I'll do that part first. We've come to the area around the hair, and this is an area that I want to tread with caution because I think that there is a great chance of messing this up right off the bat because my hair doesn't really contrast with the background too much, and that's going to make it a little bit more difficult to erase into the picture. However, there are certain things that we can do just to get started. That is to erase the majority of what's around the head just to get a little bit of a tighter crop. We can always go in with a bigger brush to make it a little bit softer just right around there. And then we can always try, and this might not work, but we can always try the background eraser tool, one of my favorite tools to just see if it works, which it's going to work in this area here. That's why I started there, because there is a little bit more contrast. But as we start to get into the little wispy hairs around the face, it's not going to work so well. And back here, it's a bit dark, so I don't know if we're going to be able to keep that. But we are going to add new hair on, which is something important to remember. So this hair that we're seeing here probably won't be kept anyway. So I'm not really worried too much about what happens as long as we don't cut into my body at all. So I'm going to leave that. I'll probably go in through here with a really soft, fuzzy, normal brush so that we can layer mask that out. I'm going to make a smaller brush, and I'm going to keep the opacity up for right now, take the hardness down, and just see what we can sort of fake. And like, this is where my process isn't totally streamlined, and I think that's okay. It's just guesswork at this point, and it always is. There are ways that you can shoot this that would be smarter, perhaps, which I say hesitantly, because it's all about what you like to do best. And my process is just very much one of, you know, doing things simply. I don't really like to shoot a lot in camera. I don't like to do a lot during the photo shoot process. So if I can keep it simple, I do. Sometimes that leads to headaches, but that's okay. So I've just taken the opacity down on my brush, and I'm just gonna go in and lightly get rid of some of the shadowy hair parts right through there. Right there, maybe right through the background here. Okay, we're gonna gather all of this hair. Copy and paste. And if you remember, we lowered the size of my body, so let's go ahead and make the hair smaller too. And I tend to keep the hair a little bit larger than it needs to be, but I just do that so that it looks a little bit more dramatic. And let's try some blending modes. So this is blending mode darken. There's lighten, which does nothing, overlay. It's always good to just go through all of your options in your blending modes, because then you can really get a sense of what you have to erase versus what might get taken care of naturally. So I'm just taking the brightness up on the hair and contrast, and that's going to help the background get erased out. So now I will try the background eraser tool on what's left here. And that's gonna work a little bit better because we did take the contrast up. So we're just gonna get through there, see what we can erase. All right, not too bad. Now I'm going to create a layer mask. And here is where I will go through and get rid of all the pieces that didn't get taken care of with the other two options. So we're still in blending mode darken, and I'm just going through and getting rid of all the parts that the background eraser tool didn't get. And now I'm going in to blend the hair into the other hair, if that makes any sense. Okay, this might be a little bit crazy, but I just want to see what this looks like if we add this hair in. This really might be crazy, so bear with me as we just take a look. I just made it a little bit brighter and with more contrast to avoid some of the issues that we had before. I just don't know. I mean, let's just see how it looks, right? So I don't know. Let's see. I'm kind of excited by it, but I don't know. Okay, let's see how this can look if we keep erasing and get this into place a little bit better. So there's a lot going on down here that we don't need because we already have a lot of hair there. Down here is where it's not quite blended. I don't know how I feel about this part. Let's see what happens if we erase it. Yeah, okay, I think I like that better. We're gonna have to blend the colors here, but that looks okay. And then finally, just around the bottom, we've got a lot of shadow happening, and that's something that might blend better later when we end up having a fair amount of changes in the background, but I like to just get rid of it right now if we can. So we'll take the opacity down, just get in there and get rid of some of those shadows. Okay. Yeah, I don't hate it. So that's a plus, isn't it? I do think that I want to bring back some of what we erased here. Keep that darkness now that there's more hair blending in there. Yeah, I think that looks looking a little bit better. And then finally, we've got a lot of purple and yellow tones happening, so I will want to take those colors down a little bit by just blending with hue saturation, making sure that the saturation is down on those layers. I'm also getting rid of my other leg, which I just thought looked weird because of the angle that it was shot at. It was like sticking up too much. So I got rid of that, pretending that my other leg is hidden back there. I think this looks pretty good so far. So let's add in the flame. Just gathering that from the image that we shot before. Because I didn't have any light on me in this particular image that I ended up choosing, I'm going to add that in now with my lasso tool by selecting where I think the light should hit. On my face, on the hair. The hair will have to be done separately because it's on a different layer. But yeah, I think that just through there, just wherever the light would naturally hit, I'm going to try to target those areas. And I'll feather 80 pixels. That might be too much. Actually, I think it is. So we'll feather 60 pixels. Okay. And first we'll start on just the subject. So I'm just going to create a little bit of brightness just on the subject. And light always has color. So here I'm going to add in yellow and red, just to give a nice little glow happening in those areas. That looks pretty good. And then I'll select that selection again, so make sure that it hits the hair that we have added in. There we go. Okay, so you can see what that light has done by undoing those layers. It's done quite a lot. So that looks pretty good. I'll work on that a little bit more later as well. I'm going to put the sky in now, and I'm just going to, if I can find it, choose the sky that we want. I think this one will be best because it has a little bit more room at the bottom. So I'm grabbing that, plopping it in, and seeing if we can, which layer is best to put it on. I think we'll have to figure that out. It might be best at the top of the layers palette. Okay. And we're gonna have to blend this sky in somehow. There are many ways that we could do it, so let's take a look at what those options are. First, there's overlay, which is always a good option to start with. It gives you a good lay of the land. Soft light, hard light. These are all options for blending skies, but I tend to use multiply more than anything else, or darken or lighten depending on the situation. But multiply is going to look a little bit heavy-handed at first, but remember that you can always change the brightness or darkness of the thing that you're adding in. So the brighter I make it, the more seamlessly it naturally sticks to that backdrop. We can also add contrast. Of course, we have a lot of options here for stuff like that. So I'm going to leave it there, and you can see that it's added an entire overlay over the subject, and that's where we're going to erase it. And the reason why I didn't just put it on the layer below the subject is because we have all this hair being blended in so that it sticks to the backdrop that we had painted in. And I don't really want to mess that up too much. So I'm just going in with a soft fuzzy brush and getting rid of it on the subject. That doesn't mean I have to get rid of it entirely. So right now this is 100% opacity. And it's really heavy. Like, you can really see how much the subject now stands out from that background because of it. So there's always the option to go in with a lower opacity and leave some of it on there, which is what I will probably do. But I like to start at 100, see how it looks, just get as much erased as I can, and then go back through and bring it back if I decide that it was too much. So I didn't get any off the hand yet. You know, I'm trying to be a little bit gentle with how I erase this because it's, of course, going to erase off the background as well if I hit that area, just like around here. So now that I have erased quite a bit of it, let's go back in. I'm gonna go with a slightly smaller brush. I'm just bringing it back where I definitely erased too much, like through here. And then we can go in with a lower opacity. I'm still just getting rid of it on the hands. This is obviously a big give and take here, just in terms of where we are erasing it, where we're not. So now I'm going to go in with a bigger brush and low opacity in the 30% range to bring it back. So I'm bringing it back over the hair in particular, where there are inconsistencies on my face a little bit. Now, I don't really want to have stripes on my face or anything like that where the texture was or where the clouds are, because that's going to look a little bit funny. So instead, I'm just going to keep that in mind as something that we want to change later, and I'm going to go in and darken my face. So that's what I'll do now, is just darken my face down with my lasso tool so that it doesn't look so bright compared to the surroundings. Okay, just darkening it. Now we can also brighten up the backdrop. It doesn't have to be a one-way street. So we have darkened my face, but we can also brighten the backdrop. I'm using my lasso tool to create a really big feathered selection on my clouds, where I will now brighten the clouds up just around me. And that way it's give and take. We can also lower the opacity on the clouds. I don't know if I will, but let's take a look at how that looks just to create a slightly softer effect in the background. But I tend to like to go full on with stuff like this. Okay. Now, one of the other issues, or perhaps it's not an issue at all, is that the backdrop is green. And I actually meant it to be gray. So we can change that right now by creating a hue saturation layer and taking that hue saturation down on the backdrop, and that also helps a little bit as well. Now, the final piece of the lighting puzzle is that the roof is really bright. All this whole entire area is quite bright, and I want to take that down so that it has a more moody effect. So I'm just selecting all around the roof where I want to make it darker. We're going to feather that 150 pixels. And just on the roof layers, we're going to make them darker. I'll even go from the highlights because they're really quite bright. That looks so much nicer. Now, the thing that you, I'm sure, notice is that I don't have a shadow underneath me. So let's go ahead and fix that. I'm just going to create wherever I think there should be a shadow. And we'll feather that 35 pixels. Curves and darken the area down underneath me. And we're gonna have to do this several times. So that was just the first pass. I think we should do another one even closer to the body right through there. Maybe at 20 pixels. There, making a darker shadow. And then another one, just casting my shadow further out onto the roof at a higher pixel feather at 80 pixels. There we go. Now we've got some shadow happening there so that I'm connected to the roof at least somewhat. Because we just created that pretty harsh shadow, I want to create a shadow on my body too, just right around the bottom part of my leg there, making sure that my leg doesn't look too bright in comparison to the shadow that we just made. Big feather, and let's go in and make that area a little bit darker too. There. Okay. So this isn't looking too bad compared to how it started. It was really rough. My goodness, wasn't it? Really. And something that I am just starting to notice as I look at this image is that I love the haziness on the roof. That's actually one of my favorite parts of this picture so far. So I want to keep that in mind as we move forward. But the other thing is that we need smoke. I want a lot of smoke coming off of this. So now we can try our blending modes. I'm just going to make sure that the smoke is connecting with the fire. There we go. And we just work through which one might be the best. So I just chose lighten, which is kind of an interesting one to use. I usually don't, because I usually have to make the smoke too bright for that. But that could be an interesting way to go depending on what you're going for. I'm not sure if that's right for us, but we can go back to that if it does end up being the best one. There's overlay, soft light. You know, soft light isn't too bad for what I want to do. Hard light is a little bit harsh, but like I said, always go into curves or whatever you like to use and just see how brightening it up or darkening it or adding contrast or taking away contrast changes the effect of what you're doing there. So if I keep that on hard light, I'm going to maybe play with the hue saturation on it as well to make it blend really nicely. And what I do notice is that we have a lot of darkness happening here, but we can always go in with our lasso tool and just section off the area that we want to change. So I might go right through there and make this area a little bit brighter through that dark spot there, just, you know, to see if it helps. And it's going to help, certainly. I don't know if it's quite the right choice, but so far this isn't too bad. So let's try erasing what we don't want from it. That's always a good place to start when you feel a little bit stuck, is just try erasing a little bit. I'm taking my opacity up, just getting rid of wherever there are harsh lines. Okay, see, I don't mind that at all. So now let's go in with a lower opacity, maybe around 50%. Take my brush down so that we're just really, really gently introducing the smoke into the background. Just like that. And now once more with an even lower opacity, smaller brush, getting in those areas that maybe feel like they didn't blend as well, wherever it's really dark, especially through here. But that looks pretty cool. I mean, I'm gonna get a little bit more of the darkness on this side, but yeah, I think this is looking pretty awesome. I like it. I'm happy. All right. Yeah. I like it. You guys, I like it. I'm really excited. Okay, good. So that's looking pretty much how I envisioned it to look. With the smoke moving into the background. And I do want it to just slightly fade into the backdrop here. So I'm just going to take my brush even bigger and keep it at that low opacity just to fade it away into the sky back there. Okay, cool. I like it. Okay. We've just done a lot of compositing in a very short period of time, so I'm going to take a minute to step back from this image and figure out the colors and where I want your eye to go in the frame, tighten up some of the compositing that we did, and get to the finished image. I really hope that you enjoyed seeing how this image came together. It was a lot of pieces to put together, from the sky, the little pieces of hair that we had to add on, the clouds, the smoke, the lighting of the candles, and more. So thank you for sticking with it. I hope that this inspires you to create something of your own. I can't wait to see your White Wall Wednesday portrait. And please let me know if you have any thoughts, comments, questions, or topics that you would like to see me tackle in future videos. Thank you so much for being here. Please subscribe and share this with anybody that you know who might like it. And have a wonderful Wednesday.